Welcome, everyone. So we're going to start a panel discussion on the Alpha Centauri session. So we have a list of panelists. I'm not going to introduce them because you can read their bio. I'm going to start right away. In the previous presentation, Pete talked about Starshot and the plan to travel to Alpha Centauri. So of course, one of the big questions we're trying to answer is, does Alpha Centauri have a planet that we would want to visit? So I'm just going to take a quick poll and ask the panelists what they think about this question and maybe even how we should answer it. So why don't you start, Sarah?
I was thinking he's going to start. Well, we know that planets want to form. We see them pretty much.
Yeah,
okay, everything that we see in our galaxy and the stars, planets want to form. There's just no question that small planets are out there waiting to be found. So based on the talks yesterday, everything, I'll say yes, there's definitely planets there somewhere. Probably within 2.5 AU.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. And yesterday, there was at least one slide shown talking about the probabilities of planets. And there's still a lot of uncertainty about that question. But I think we can probably rule out very low numbers, like a few percent. And it's not out of the question that there could be very high numbers, like approaching one. So one thing we don't know is whether planets around binary stars form with the same efficiency as they do around single stars. But there's, you know, we also don't know that they don't form with the same efficiency. So it's reasonable to expect that they do. So I think it's very reasonable to expect that there's pretty high chance of finding potentially habitable planets around Alpha Centauri.
I would say something is along the same line. Let's be an optimist. Let's say we can go there. We can have a look. There should be planets just on our doorsteps that could be habitable, hopefully around our closest stars. That's basically the premises. What would be really interesting is, as you just mentioned, is like, do planets form at the same rate in binary stars? There were a lot of reasons why we thought they wouldn't form at all. But now we actually figured out that there are some. We found some giant planets. And so the question is, are the small ones out there? And therefore, in a way, I would say the Alpha Centauri system is maybe even more interesting, because it's going to, if we were to find a planet there in the habitable zone, that would actually answer that question too.
Yeah, so I would like to add that 20 years ago, we didn't even know that there were some planets there. And we started to find one. And then we started to find 10. And today, we are at more than 2,000 planets with Kepler. And what all this told us is that the more you go to smaller planets, the more there is planets there. So I'm really convinced that, perhaps not if you just focus on one system, Alpha Centauri, but at least if you take the 10 closest stars to the solar system, there is plenty of planets there.
I was going to say, Olivier, we need a contrarian.
Yes. We'll see if we get one. There's two more chances.
Okay, so for Chinese people, the Alpha Centauri is more interesting. So I suppose some of you may read the scientific fiction called The Three-Body Problem. It's written by a Chinese guy. So that story happened in Alpha Centauri, actually. So we already to think about some intelligent life lives around there. So then we return to for science. I agree with the panel. I think there was some planets around there, but I will say maybe 25% or it will be the Earth. So we are going to find it.
So I'm on the end of the distribution. I would say not only is there a planet there, but if we take the principle that we're not special and we extrapolate some of the ideas we heard earlier, which are centered around this idea that maybe the complexity of life takes longer to evolve than we've had time here on Earth, and maybe life here was actually seeded. If it was, then I'm kind of thinking that we're going to find life in Alpha Centauri, and that, in fact, it's not just by chance that there's life here, but it's a system which is nearby, and that in fact, I'm in that category of six nines that we're going to find a planet, and I'm thinking we're even going to find life.
Can I just add to that? Because in this kind of conversation, I think it's also good to have a devil's advocate. Because I think what's going to be so fascinating about the search as well is actually it's going to revolutionize our understanding about life. Because I think the idea that we have is based on the evolutionary timescale of the one system that we know, our own planet, right? So all these aspects of how long it would take to actually get to intelligent life if you want it, whether you could seed it because it's there and so on, and the age of the star would actually determine what evolutionary stage the planet is, all of this is completely open and part of the search. And so I applaud the sentiment that you say, well, you know, it could be seeded from there, and the sci-fi book is really interesting, I do have to say, I like that one. We have, of course, Pandora as well, right? So a Hollywood movie. But I think the optimism that we have, all of us, because we're working on this, needs to get scientifically founded now. And this is why the search is so critical. And so I think I just wanted to put this in perspective because you're the arch and you were saying we might be seated from there. So I think we can also go back and say, look, this is what we all wish to find. But we have to always be very careful, as we all know, as scientists. And this is why looking is so much fun.
We have one data point. We haven't seen spacecraft traveling in our solar system at 20% of speed of light. Therefore, Alpha Centauri does not have a Yuri Milner, not 50 years ago.
We have 20 years to go.
It's very difficult to see
them. Oh, so we may have missed them.
Yeah, they move each other. They're small, but they move also fast. If you see.
Okay, I guess we do not have any data point. I wanna go the other way now. The panel is very optimistic, but there's a significant challenge here. We talked about ways yesterday that we would attempt to see habitable planets around Alpha Centauri, and those measurements are quite challenging. I think you know the speakers pointed out that we're right at the limit with the first wave of missions. With the sensitivity we'll have to see actually habitable planets, we'll probably be able to see bigger planets like Super Earth. So there is someone on this panel that can relate to this, and I want Xavier to tell a little story about Alpha Centauri.
So everything started back in 2008, where like a lot of people started to observe Alpha Centauri B quite intensively, and there was Michael that presented what he did yesterday, and we did it as well with the Geneva team on HOPS, and we really decided to observe the star really a lot of time. We got in total 20,000 spectra, so very similar to what Michael did. And after 4 years of measurement of Alpha Centauri B, then a small signal pop up, 50 centimeters per second, so 5 times bigger than the signal of the Earth, so very small. And this was a planet, well, at the time we said this was a planet orbiting the star at 3.2 days because we tried to remove all the different signals from the star and so on, and there was just this left. But now there have been a few papers, and mainly the last one that was published a few months ago, that shows that in fact the signal is indeed in the data, but it's not due to a planet. It's just due to the sampling of the data. So all this to say that we showed yesterday that there was plenty of different techniques that will be at the limit of perhaps finding an habitable planet around Alpha Centauri. And the thing is that all this technique will be really at the limit, so we'll never be sure if there is a planet there or not. But what I want to focus on is that if we can, like, we should use all the different techniques we have now to be able to find something there, because if one technique tells us that perhaps there is something there, and we can use the other technique to also show that there is something, then we'd really be convinced that there is a planet there. If we just have one technique, then it will be much more difficult.
Thank you. We've been working actually on a range of techniques to detect and image habitable planets around Alpha Centauri, and so we have a panel of about 20 people that have been working on this. So you heard yesterday about some of those things, but not all of them. So I wanted to give a little bit of time to describe some of the things we didn't have time to talk about. I'll start by asking Jeff to tell us a little bit more about very large telescopes.
So one of the issues that we have to face is that the likelihood is that we won't actually detect something. We're all optimists, as you've learned, at various parts of that spectrum. And I think one of the concerns of the panel has been to lay the groundwork with whatever the outcome of the search is for future progress. And future progress means detection with extremely large telescopes, and we were optimistic about what will come from those extremely large telescopes. I represent a group of scientists that have been engaged in this effort to try and develop a telescope or an optical system which is optimized to be able to do high contrast imaging and to be able to look for life and maybe even civilized life. Throughout this meeting a couple of times I've mentioned this notion that there is a thermodynamic signature for life which we might be able to see on a planet which is orbiting a star within, say, 20 parsecs. Once a telescope reaches 100 meters in size, we have now the capability of finding that thermodynamic signature and even doing a census for life on a few hundred stars. That really takes us into a regime where what we're starting now becomes science. The Fermi paradox becomes a scientific question, not a question based on sociology or issues that we can't quantify. So I think that there is a major effort which goes on beyond what we're doing here now. We hope that this activity stimulates and encourages and makes more of us optimists for the ability to develop something which is really dedicated to this question of finding life or even finding advanced life in our corner of the universe.
So with any ground-based telescope, even a giant as one you can conceive, how do you hope to see the atmosphere of that other planet if it's just like our atmosphere and our atmospheric signals are just so big?
So at 5 microns or 10 microns, as we know, we have windows, and that window is big enough that we can collect enough photons as the planet rotates, similar to how we image stars that we don't resolve. We make star spot images which are essentially based on molecular lines or based on thermal emission, and that rotating signature can be inverted over the course of many observations during the orbit and the rotation of the planet to make a picture of the surface of the planet. Of course, it's not easy. We have to be able to, and there are systems where we could never do that. A planet like Venus, we could never invert to get a picture of what's on the surface. But life is about energy. And so even just the thermal signature associated with the photosynthetic conversion of solar energy is an interesting number. The number to think about here is that right now we're using 10 to the minus 4 of the total power that strikes the Earth. We're creating, we're using that much power, and we're turning it into heat. It's our waste heat. 10 to the minus 4 is therefore the contrast number. It's a measure of our civilization, if you like. 10 to the minus 4 of the total power that the Earth receives. So in a more advanced civilization, not much more advanced, you could imagine that number slightly larger, and if it's more concentrated on the planet as the planet rotates, that inversion problem becomes easier and easier. And at 100 meters in size, we'll be able to look for that in a statistical sense.
We're just starting to realize how tough it will be to anywhere near robustly identify life elsewhere. We'll probably need different techniques, not just one.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, it pays to think about broader spectral coverage.
And the biomarkers that you've talked about and others, I think, Lisa, and polarization signals that Svetlana has mentioned, are all the bonus to this sort of a specialized instrument that comes online, we hope not too much further into the future. And you're right, the search for simple life through biomarkers is of course perfectly done with an instrument which is optimized to minimize scattered light. It itself is a coronagraph and has the reach to be able to do the problem statistically, hundreds of stars within.
Can I actually add up on this? I think one of the points that we were talking about is like, you want the coverage. You don't want one signal that's like Sarah's point. You want to have a conformation in the different wavelength range. So looking at, for example, a thermal feature, right? That's going to be interesting either way, because what about if the interior of the planet is completely different? What about if the geological cycles are very different? So things like that, where we don't have an insight because we only have our own planet, need to extrapolate, will be much better with data. But attributing the data to what it is, whether it's civilization and waste heat, or whether it's actually internal heating, is gonna be the fascinating challenges that we have. And we're gonna be able to do that with more information, meaning different wavelengths coverage, to actually give us pieces of the puzzle. So I agree. From the ground, these 100 meter telescopes are going to be amazing and a step forward, and we're going to be able to get some of the coverage in the visible, of course, but the complementary, hopefully in the infrared, to get the information that the chemicals really are there and what the concentrations would be due to the different effects of the star and so on. It is different in the visible what the effects are than the infrared. But the one point that I wanted to make here from before, what this also shows us, what I would like to give to the breakthrough initiative as a as an add-on to their very simple chips. I don't want a picture. Thanks for the picture, I love it. But you need to have some spectroscopic coverage, because what you just brought up, Venus or 100% cloud coverage, I'd be happy to know the clouds are gray, but I'd love to know what the atmospheric composition, even of the atmosphere above that cloud layer is, if I can't go down, right? So some spectroscopic coverage, you know, color is one thing, but some spectroscopic coverage, and I know there are visionary people working on this chip, so please put at least some filters on it, because a picture of a fuzzy dot with lots of clouds is going to be amazing and on the cover of New York Times, but the scientists are behind you and saying, like, so what are the clouds made out of? What's the air made out of? Come on, you send it all the way there. That's one of the things I wanted to say. Please add that on. As we said yesterday, it's so easy to make your chips. Just put a couple of more spectrographic in for your noise.
For a few more milligrams.
Yes.
We also explored and discussed ideas that were suborbital. So I want to ask Christian to tell us just a few words on what we, about balloons and chronograph balloons, which is something we discussed.
I don't know what happened last night, but I lost my voice. so we look at suborbital balloons. So overall, it's a very promising platform where you just install your instrument, put the big balloon with helium or hydrogen, go up to 40 kilometers, and start to do your science. And it's very cheap. It's somewhat cheaper than low orbital satellites. And you know, you can recover sometime your payload. It's around 80% chance. Or depending when you fly, you might actually land in water. That happened in northern Quebec in a few times. But you have a very nice platform. You can test drive, fly your chronograph, or whatever system you want to fly, test it coming back down, and test it next year, fly again. So we look into that. It seemed to be a very, very good system to do these kind of science. But it does come with some amount of difficulties. One of the issues is you have a balloon in above you, and when you want to look at your stars, usually balloons are being designed to look down toward the Earth. But for us, we want to look up. And if you like to look up, there's a balloon filling up 75% of your sky. That's a big problem. And of course, you're limited in size of your telescope that you could put in on these things. So you want to be integrate a long time to be able to do discoveries of these planets. And the most obvious target to look at with these balloons is Alpha Centauri. And Alpha Centauri is at around minus 60. So then you need to find a place to fly your balloon to be able to observe Alpha Centauri. So one option is Antarctica. But if you go to Antarctica to get the good winds, Alpha Centauri is under the balloon for most of the time. So that's a big problem. So the next option is South America, and then fly these super long duration balloons that you can stay up for months. But then Alpha Centauri goes up to zenith. So it's spending most of the time under the Earth, or again, under the balloon. So you only have a small area for a few hours, and then you lose a target. And we know all these chronographs takes a long time to acquire and build a dark hole to be able to see these planets. It's not. Even it's a very promising platform to test the technology and do some amount of science, my belief was it's probably hard to think about the balloon experiment that we'd be able to get to habitable planets. There's already a team that's pushing this forward. The Picture-C team got funding. And so we'll see how well they can develop this technology.
Thank you. And Webb also helped us look at suborbital starshade ideas. So maybe, Webb, you can tell us a few words about this.
After inventing starshade 10 years ago, we started testing them and expecting that they would have the same problems in the atmosphere that internal coronagraphs do. And we weren't seeing that. We put it in a tank, pumped it down, and there was no change. It took several years to figure out why the physics behind that, but in fact, it turns out starshades work extremely well in the atmosphere. We've taken that to a level of testing now. Many of you have seen the desert test results. And now we're actually working with a siderostat. It's actually the heliostat at Kitt Peak. And making stars completely disappear. It's really quite astonishing to see a field of view where Sirius or Vega or Arcturus used to be there and then nothing. So we're feeling very good about that. Starshades just work. What we're doing is pushing on the inner working angle, which means that we have to have larger separations with the starshade in alignment with the telescope to the target. And so that's changed it from an optics problem to an engineering problem. And for 5 years now, I've been trying to get NASA to support a proposal I actually have called Mission to Alpha Centauri, just to try to get their attention. Didn't work. But we can, in fact, image into the habitable zone of Alpha Centauri with starshades that are no more than about a meter across. So we're going down that road. We've reached 10 arc seconds in our working angle. We need to get closer to 1 to hit the habitable zone. But at the moment, the contrast is under control, and now we're just pushing on separation issues. And there are a number of different geometries that can get us there on a very short time scale. I've been launching rockets and payloads with experimental techniques for many decades now. And anything you can do on the ground, you should do on the ground. And not go into space, because space is a huge distraction, slows you down. Said by a rocket scientist, do it on the ground if you can. That actually also, if you can do something remotely rather than going there, you should do it remotely. And there's a lesson there for the Starshot. If we can do it remotely with big telescopes, it's not the key part of the payload that is actually goes to Alpha Centauri.
Thank you. I want to ask Russ, what is sitting in front of him?
So this is a 3D model of an early version of a concept you heard about yesterday called ASAT, Alpha Centauri Exoplanet Satellite, that Eduardo and I proposed in 2014. So, and Eduardo printed, 3D printed this model, which is at 50% scale. And it's amazing that you can 3D print something that's pretty close to the size. And if we had a bigger printer, we could print the actual full size model. And so this particular one is a 35 centimeter by 18 centimeter elliptical mirror here, and is designed to fit into a 27 cube set, capable of directly imaging Earth-like planets around Alpha Centauri. And so I should also mention that something like this is pretty complementary to some of the other efforts you're hearing about, such as the 10 micron effort that Jeff is talking about and others are doing, the astrometry concepts to measure the mass of planets around Alpha Centauri. All of these things are getting different data and different bands or different parameters, and all of them form a complete picture of what of the planets that we would see around Alpha Centauri and around other stars as well.
Thank you. So we can't wait to see the full version with good quality optics.
I think one of the other things that is adding to this, and what Xavier was saying today too, AlphaSen is an amazing close-by system, and you mentioned that yesterday too, but we really have close-by star systems, and for example, another effort is TESS, where we're going to look at all the closest, brightest stars, and like with Kepler, just with a small aperture, we're going to look for the planets in the habitable zone of really cool stars. And those, they will fly 217, and then we will have some more targets. So I think we are right now visionary, of course, looking at the closest stars. But this could just be a game changer in a year or two, where we know around our 10 closest stars are X planets, right? Or around our 20 closest stars are so many more, and then we get to cherry pick, hopefully. So I see this also, as you mentioned yesterday, as the first point on whether we find something around Alpha Centauri or not, as you were saying. Well, we're developing for the closest star, but if we size it up a little bit, we might be able to do it for many more, and we'll get targets to come.
So maybe I can comment on that a little bit. I'm very much looking forward to the results of tests, and I think all of these efforts are great at letting us know what planets are out there. But Alpha Centauri is pretty special, and it's not just the tip of the iceberg. I like to say that it's its own iceberg. And even though we have M stars that are almost as close as Alpha Centauri, the habitable zones on the sky, the angular size of those habitable zones on the sky, are much smaller than around Alpha Centauri. And so, for example, for Barnard Star or Proxima Sen, you would need a 10-meter telescope to resolve a habitable zone around those stars, I believe. So for some reason, nature has given us this one star system, Alpha Centauri, that is a very much of a favorable outlier in how large its habitable zone appears on the sky in terms of its angular size. So to directly image a habitable zone of any other FGKM star on the sky, you need a telescope that's about 3 times larger than what you can do around Alpha Centauri.
Yeah, and we'll have those on the ground in the future.
Yes, I do.
So that's a great segue into M-type stars. Of course, the real closest star is Proxima Centauri. It's an M-type star, and there's a lot of M-type stars nearby. They're more abundant than FGK-type stars. What do you think about occurrence and of life around M-type stars? Is it harder? Is it easier? And I realize a lot of us have different opinions on this. And also the instrumentation prospects of going after those targets.
One thing people have realized recently, I think it might even be thanks to Jack Lissauer and others, that these M stars have a very, very long pre-mate sequence. And now people have started running evolution models and looking at the ultraviolet radiation. And there have been some like crazy things out there that actually seem maybe even believable, that with this very hundred or hundreds of millions of years, your planet that's in the habitable zone today actually wasn't in the habitable zone for all that long time. And people have imagined even scenarios where you have a runaway greenhouse and the ocean goes away, and then the water that's locked in the mantle comes out, and you kind of exhaustively, sequentially, get rid of all this water, and the oxygen stays left over and completely saturates the surface, and not only makes a false positive, but also makes it poisonous for life. Hmm. So that's an argument against it. I just thought I'd start out with something negative, because the committee has been so positive.
I think the idea is, let's follow up on this, because we actually did lots of these models. So the important part is that when you look at an M-star and the evolution, as Sarah was saying, we're starting to think out of the box, because we were thinking about our own sun. That's just our default setting, right? And our own sun needed about 500 million years to get to the nuclear fusion stage. Now we looked at, we actually discussed this over coffee, this is how we got to there. We were like, what about small stars? And we're like, oh, it's worth the look. And it's actually, you can get a planet in the habitable zone of a pre-main sequence small star, M-star, for 2.5 billion years. So I'm not saying that life would develop at that stage, but we added some new targets to the list. And that, as Sarah was saying, that region is actually further away from the star. So the first question that came up is like, what does that do? Because then in the stars that we now consider to be in the habitable zone of the main sequence, the lifetime when the star is like in our sun's lifetime, those ones are now the one that were incredibly hot initially, and they could have actually evaporated all their water. So we looked into this and into dynamics, because what you can argue is you could lose all that water, you could even deplete the mantle if you want, but you actually have a lot of the water that we currently have that came actually from space, right? So we basically have a lot of the water on the Earth that was not the initial inventory that we had. So you can just easily imagine that you could actually just get more water, right? So that's, I really appreciate that Sarah actually started out with the negative one, because these are key things that we can envision either way. We can make this work, and then you'd have a lot of water, and you'd have life on M stars. And we know that M stars, from all we see, tend to make more small planets, so they're even better if you want. And the interesting thing in that, too, is like, a lot of times it gets very misconstrued, because we're thinking about a tightly locked, synchronously tightly locked planet if we think about M stars, because the habitable zone is so close, as we just talked about. But A, tidally locking in a synchronous orbit is very unlikely. And even if you do, the atmosphere as well as the oceans actually transport that heat. You're not talking about Mercury. You're talking about a planet that actually has air, and that air will transport energy. And all of these things are so new because we don't have a red sun in our sky. And a lot of work still needs to be done on that, but we have handles on at least part of it. And I think we could make the argument either way, as Sarah was pointing
Lisa
out.
Yeah, Lisa and I could basically talk forever, and the great thing is that when you do models and have theories, you can pretty much come up with anything, usually. So that's why the observers are supposed to break in and say, we're going to look anyway, you can theorize forever, and we have our certain set of targets, the close by ones, we're going to be looking at them no matter what. And that's what my observer friends have told me.
I completely agree, and I think this is what we're doing. We're actually making distinguishable figures that all these models will tell you how to tell things apart, because that's the key thing, because we try to identify the planets where we won't be able to tell anything, because those are the ones we don't want to waste our time with lots and lots of observations. So we're trying to actually find a prioritization effort. And M-star planets are insofar really interesting because some of the, this goes back to the wavelength coverage, some of the false positives that Sarah was mentioning would actually show up in some wavelengths but not in others. So we're starting to learn from the observational point of view what we actually need to do to solidify anything that we call a biomarker.
So speaking of models and various scenarios, nature has fooled us into being actually even more imaginative than we have been. A lot of the exoplanet discoveries have been quite surprising things that a lot of us thought were not going to happen. Very close-in giant planets, for example. I'm going to ask you, each one of you, a very tricky question. Can you guess a big surprise that we're going to see when we look at Alpha Centauri? And in a few decades, when you win, maybe we can convince Breakthrough to engrave your name on one of their sales, or some other crazy prize. Sarah, what is your guess?
All right, I'll give you my guess, which is also my dream, that after all this crazy speculation, and we'll spend like our whole careers on this, we're going to find the true Earth twin, and it'll be so obviously an Earth with life on it that we will be home free.
Well, Sarah stole my answer, but let me give you another answer. I think we will find some weird object that dynamicists did not predict, and that is doing something weird dynamically. I don't know what it's going to be.
Which is?
I think you're cheating with this contest. Your answer is too vague.
I don't know. A figure eight. I know a figure eight is impossible, but something like that.
I would follow what I think we're going to find as we're thinking about this Earth twin. But I think we're going to find the Earth twin, but it's not going to be like we imagine it, right? It's going to be completely different. Life. Dinosaurs didn't die out. It's like a tiny, tiny change in evolution. But just go from initial settings, a completely different kind of biota is becoming the dominant life form. And the planet can be pretty similar to us in everything except a tiny bit. And this is the surprises.
Yes,
I'm
actually,
really
I just want to bolster that by people who work on our own Earth. They think it may have two or three different equilibrium states. And that just something strange in its evolution landed it in one versus another. So that's a cool idea.
And so I think when we talk about Earth twin, you know, don't think about the picture you know. Think about an amazing yellowish picture or greenish or whatever color you want, whatever kind of species you can imagine. And I think that's going to be one of
maybe
the
maybe you're
fascinating
thinking Planet things of the Apes kind of scenario.
No, actually, I'm thinking go to the underwater oceans and imagine this weird fish and they evolved on our planet. Just imagine what somewhere else could evolve and how surprising that will be.
Xavier?
Yeah, I would like to add on this. It's true that if you speak about habitability, in fact, there is a lot of studies that show that perhaps some planets that are different from Earth can be more habitable than Earth. And there is this concept of superhability, where you could have a planet of 5-6 Earth mass that could be more habitable than the Earth because you have better tectonics and so on. So I think we'll be quite surprised. If we are able to find life somewhere in the universe, we'll be really surprised how it will be, in fact.
I think the nice thing, if I can just, very small thing, this is where Sarah was saying our modeling, right? Because we can actually, there are two teams, one saying it's super habitable and the other one saying, there's no way a bigger thing can be habitable. So this is why the looking is going to be so important, as you were saying, the surprises, right?
We have to stay open-minded.
In any event, I thought yesterday people were putting limits on the mass of an Earth that could be hiding in the Alpha Centauri system.
Okay, before I go to Japan or New Zealand, I just simply thought their building will be very fragile because there are some earthquakes there. But actually, when I come there, it's wrong. They are very strong, the building is, because they have many experience. So for Alpha Centauri, it's a binary system, so people simply thought it's the dynamics or circumstances too complicated and too bad there. But maybe when we come there, we will find some life there is more stronger than the people, human beings on Earth. But I that may be not so intelligent as the people, but the body will be very strong and
maybe super strong dinosaurs that can withstand the asteroid impact.
Yes.
Jeff?
Well, let's take the super habitability a little bit further. So by the time Breakthrough Starshot reaches there, they'll have another 20 years to advance. So I'm imagining a race of 20 or more advanced creatures that have, by the third or the fourth of these line of little chips that reach there, they've figured out how to catch them, and they're going to send one back to us with a message. That's what I'm looking for. 40 years after that, a new message back to us.
So if you win, I think we'll make a really good prize for you. Yes, Jack.
Terraformable, uninhabited planet. It's much more terraformable than, say, Mars or Venus.
And that's for the outside works for our future, right?
Just in case it didn't come through to the listeners, it's actually, he said, Jack Lissauer just said he imagines a planet that's uninhabited, but terraformable. So imagine it's a place for humanity to go if needed.
It's a Star Trek fan. Vacation.
So I asked each one of you to prepare one slide, and I asked you to be thinking out of the box, if possible. So we're going to go through those slides. I think a clicker here, so I don't know in which order they are. I think the first one is Russ. So just briefly, a couple of minutes.
Sure. So when I'm not thinking about how to directly image planets around Alpha Centauri, I sometimes think about how we might get there, which is, you know, connected to Starshot. And one thing that is kind of a common thing for people and for science fiction authors specifically to think is that the speed of light limit is bad for interstellar travel. You can't go past the speed of light, so it takes 4 years to get to Alpha Centauri. It takes millions of years to get to the Andromeda Galaxy, and so on. That's true, but I think there's a much more fundamental issue here. Suppose we lived in a Newtonian universe. We would still be limited traveling at 1G, if at least we're talking about human travel. You don't want to be in a spaceship that goes at 60,000 Gs like Breakthrough Shot does. And if you have a spaceship that, for half of its trip, spends 1G or is accelerating at 1G, and for the second half spends 1G decelerating at 1G, putting aside about the engineering challenges of how you might do that, it still would take you something like 4 or 5 years to get to Alpha Centauri. So from that point of view, it doesn't matter if you live in a relativistic universe or a Newtonian universe, it still takes you that much time to get to Alpha Centauri. And so this plot shows the travel times in a Newtonian universe and relativistic universe, depending on the distance. To get to the Andromeda Galaxy, you know, it still takes you like 2,000 years. It doesn't take you 2.5 million years Earth time that it would take a starship to get to the Andromeda Galaxy, but it still takes you thousands of years, which is impractical. However, what relativity does give you is that it shortens the starship time. So if you are on the starship and you are traveling to the center of the galaxy, it only takes you 20 years starship time to get there, which is much shorter than it would take you in the Newtonian universe to travel to the center of the galaxy at 1G. The edge of the universe, if we are, I mean, putting aside expansion and so on, just 46 billion light years away, starship time would take you 48 years. Yes, that's why I did that caveat, that putting aside the expansion of the universe. Yes, absolutely. But so what the speed of light limit enables you, I mean, speed of light limit is connected to the relativistic universe, it actually enables you to go anywhere you want in the universe with that caveat, accelerating universe, within a human lifetime, while billions of years pass on Earth. So far in the future, I think billionaires could retire and do a grand tour of the universe in their lifetime.
But no stopping.
No, well, they can stop. No. This is stopping at that place. This is accelerating and then decelerating and then going back. And of course, when they do that, they would not only be doing a grand tour of space, but also a grand tour of time, because once they get back to Earth, billions of years would pass. But no Earth then, yes. But the point here is that the speed of light limit, rather than limiting interstellar human travel, it enables interstellar human travel.
Very interesting. So I think the lesson here is if you know, you want to be the one traveling, not the one staying on Earth and waiting for the traveler to come back. Next slide, Anthony.
I just want to invite you to share this music. It's very famous in China, called Flowing Water. It's actually composed 2,000 years ago. And this song means we try to find your close friends, and your friends will can understand your songs to each other. And this song was also recorded in the disc of the Voyager 1 and Voyager 2, and we try to find our friends in space. So, and next, please. And I think if we want to get our resonant sounds with our friends, we have many choice, and we have to choose the right way to get the right signals from them. And we also try to send or express our signals. So, and I think in the future for exoplanet or intelligent life detection, there are many different techniques we should do. They collaborate and synergize each other. And for example, we have imaging, we have transit, but also before do that, maybe we should do some astrometry to find where there is. And finally, I will express our mission is proposed in China is astrometry called STEP. And Alpha Centauri were our first target. We will tell you, and if there is some habitable zone planets around there, and after that we can do some imaging, and we can to start short. So that's all.
Thank you. I don't know who prepared this slide. This is
the
colorful slide. You told me you would be surprising me.
Yes, it's okay.
Oh, okay.
So Olivier asked us to be a little bit visionary, so let me bring what I said before. I usually talk about spectra, because that's what we can get with the telescope we're envisioning. But really, if you think a little bit out of the box, as I was mentioning before, life could be so different. And it's hard for us to imagine. But these are just a couple of samples of what we have, what's called a color catalog, that's completely open and free for anybody who wants to use it on the Carl Sagan Institute website, because we basically just measured 140 different biota that we know of the Earth, from the very extreme to non-extreme environments, and just give you what their reflectivity, what their properties are, because you could vision planets to be very different looking. I was talking about colors, and then using those to prioritize. But of course, I want to put in the caveat, the last one is Venus. Because the color can be from the ground or from the atmosphere, and it's going to be very hard to tell. Thus, I would like spectroscopy, please, in addition to the image that you can give me. And one of the things that I like to mention, Olivier said, to also do it a little bit funny, what do you mean extreme? We love it here. What's extreme to us is not extreme even to life forms that we know on our own Earth. So this pale blue dot for us could be a very, very different kind of planet. But we are already learning through our modeling and through looking at Earth that we know and on all the kinds of life that we know on Earth, how these spectral fingerprint, this atmospheric composition could actually tell us for life on planets that are different from ours, not even envisioning synthetic biology or so. But that's what I wanted to leave you with. The spectral fingerprint of a planet is our link to read what's going on other worlds and explore other worlds. And this is a very strong endeavor that we're trying from the modeling side to envision other worlds and understand what signatures we can actually look for. And then when we get there with breakthrough starshot, I'd like the picture with spectroscopy place.
Thank you. I'll take the clicker back. This is scary. It sounds like we can make any spectra as a linear combination of those colors.
I think that's the question we're asking, a database of spectra to make sure that we actually know what we're seeing.
Next slide. Who's this?
Mine, actually. Okay, well, since I believe that many of us are here because we want to find life. We have SETI here. We have direct imaging. And right now, I just want to give you a very brief update of the biosignature gas community's thinking. I don't represent the community by any means, but lately, there's been a question about oxygen and how great of a biosignature is it. Actually, what's so interesting is the famous astronomer Jeans, he actually apparently retired from astronomy and wrote a bunch of popular books. And one of his books from 1930 actually first mentions the thought of using oxygen as a bioindicator of life elsewhere, perhaps. So for a long time, it had just been kind of standard. Of course, we want to look for oxygen. Now some Earth scientists are wondering, you know, how did we get so much extra oxygen here? We breathe oxygen, other life produces it. And so there's what I call a cottage industry now. In the last couple of years, there have at least like 10 or 15 different papers, including from Lisa's team, about a false positive for oxygen. And many of them actually, the message for you is that to sort through them all, like we may never sort through all of them. Some cases will obviously be a false positive, but only with a broad and high spectral resolution coverage. That was my first message. So stay tuned and see what the community figures out. The second thing is, you know, if we have Alpha Centauri, if that's our best candidate, and we find a planet there, and we devote all our resources for spectroscopy, do we want to miss a chance of finding a biosignature just because we weren't smart enough to think of anything else? So a few years ago, my team went off on a kind of a tangent, and we decided to consider that life on Earth produces thousands of molecules. In fact, our atmosphere, every gas to the part per trillion level, is produced by life, although it usually has a dominant source other than life. And we have basically enumerated all molecules that will be in gas form at STP. It sounds a little obscure, and we actually have another non-exoplanet reason for making this list. And so we hope to go through the list with different classes and types of molecules and really just see what could possibly be a biosignature gas, especially if you folks are telling me that your big telescope is going to operate in a narrow window. We want to make sure we can cover all possibilities. So the field is a bit in flux now. We have apparently our own conference in biosignature this summer. It's such a big field. So many people are starting to work on it as we're getting closer and closer to reality. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes. Jeff, you're next.
So I guess I'm us people. So I know that most people think that we're a long way from having a really big telescope available just to study or do a census of life in our corner of the universe. But there is a group of serious people. Some of them include the builders of the Keck telescope or the contractors that are going to build the TMT telescope. And that collaboration is convinced that there's an important number that will enable building telescopes that are 100 meters or larger, or arrays of these telescopes that make the beamers for the system that you saw earlier today. The number that you want to know about is a mass, and it's a fact of physics, right? That even though we're miniaturizing the ships, we have to maximize the size of the thing that's here on Earth that provides the energy concentration that we need ultimately to make these things work, or the receiver that allows us to be able to see the biomarkers, be they spectroscopic or thermal, that tell us about life. This group is involved in taking this number, which is 200 kilograms per square meter, which is what we live with now for the total mass of an optical system, down to two orders or almost two orders of magnitude smaller, 5 kilograms. And their optical tricks and their additive manufacturing, and you can imagine you can't afford to build huge telescopes if you have to polish them the same way that we do now. But we think that we have a roadmap for getting to that. So let me invite you to come to Maui, where the world's largest coronagraph is really looking at the nearest star. That coronagraph is 4.2 meters, and it's a solar telescope, and it's designed to look at our circumstellar environment very locally. And it uses some optical tricks, like it's off-axis, and it's part of, I think, the future of all optical systems that we build. But in the future, we have another off-axis telescope. It's going up on Haleakala, devoted to exoplanet studies. And it's not big enough to do all the things that we're talking about, but it's another step towards very thin mirrors. Ultimately, the path is to what we've been calling the Colossus, which is a bunch of mirrors that are as big as you can make them, and much, much thinner, and they approach this mass limit right there. And when you get to that mass limit, the cost, and this is the other number on that slide that's important, which is $1,000 per kilogram, which means that a telescope that has a moving mass of 1,000 kilograms is already a big number. So, to make these telescope systems that are going to do the exoplanet studies that we're after means to decrease the mass. To decrease the mass means using optical tricks and 3D printing and additive technologies to make the mirrors. So this telescope right here, we would not only print the structure, but we'd like to print the optics. We think we can do that, and we're close to it. Thanks.
Thank you. We have one more slide.
Okay, so what I want to show with this slide is that I really think that the radial velocity technique is not dead. So we know that when you try to go and focus on Earth-like planets that are very far away from the star in the habitable zone, then the signal is extremely small, and we are really facing all the problems that the star is creating. The star is creating a lot of signals, and this is the main problem that we have. So thinking a little bit of the box, when we are looking to other stars, we don't know what is happening on these other stars. So just try to focus and look at the sun, because we know everything about the sun. We have plenty of satellites that observe the sun constantly. You know if you have sunspots, you know plenty of things about the sun. So we started this small project at CFA, which is a small telescope, solar telescope, just to get the light from the sun. And then we plug it into the best spectrograph we have in the world, which is Hobbs North. And on the top, here, you can see the radial velocity of the sun. So we observe the sun 5-6 hours every day. And here you have 8 months of observation. And you see a radial velocity RMS of about 2 meters per second. So then if you want to detect an Earth is 10 centimeters per second. So you are really far from that. And all this is really due to sunspots passing by on the surface of the sun. But then you can just use different models to try to fit all this signal coming from the star. And when you do that, because you have really an excellent sampling, then your model is really tightened up. And in the bottom, you can see just by using the Gaussian process that after fitting the data, we are left with 30 centimeters per second. So it's not yet an Earth. It's not yet 10 centimeters per second. But we are not very far from that. And this is, we are using an instrument here that is at more or less 1 meter per second in precision. And if in next year, or in 2 years from now, we'll have new generation spectrograph, which has a stability of 10 centimeters per second. There is the Expresso spectrograph built in Geneva. There is also Deborah Fisher that is building her own spectrograph that should be at 10 centimeters per second. So I really think we can go there. I really think it's possible. Thank you.
Thank you. So now we're going to take questions for the audience, for the panelists.
Yes. First, an advertisement, which is back to the subject of M-dwarfs. At the SETI Institute, we've started a survey of 20,000 M-dwarf stars using the Allen Telescope Array. So it would be really fun to be here next year and report that we found something. We'll let everybody know. But we agree on the intriguing element of M-dwarfs as candidate host stars. The question I have is, in the Drake equation, to me, the most provocative and interesting variable is L.
And the pessimist among us might say that, you know, L may be inversely proportional to the technological advancement of a particular civilization. I'd be interested in the panel's thoughts about more highly evolved species than us that have either passed through a technological phase or have never gone through a technological phase and yet are evolutionarily more advanced than we.
So I think starting out with that, we don't know, and that's what I was trying to say before, what actually times evolution. There's ideas that actually impact, for example, are good for evolution, and there are as compelling theories that say that are bad. So the age of a planet is our first indicator, but the evolutionary timescale on that planet might be very, very different than ours. So as that caveat. And you were saying, maybe they don't go through a technology phase. Just envision an ocean planet, very easy. You could see algae bloom, you could have very highly evolved, maybe not call it fish, but something like that. Would they build telescopes? Would they build technology? You know, things like that. And I think this is why it's so crucial for us to actually think a little bit outside of the box, because we are so beholden to the one example that we know, our own Earth. And to me, that is also where I think it's great that SETI now stretches out their thinking, because this is one evolutionary path with one timeline. But maybe what could potential other signatures be when the civilization doesn't go through our evolutionary steps? And I think this is why this biosignature research that we're doing to actually look for gases in the atmospheres that will tell you about biology and their caveats in there, and we're working on a lot of different things, is so compelling, because it gives you a complementary set of how you can find life that has done a completely different evolution, if you want, even so we might not understand the signatures in the first place. But so your question about going through this evolutionary step, to me, is basically based on the assumption of this one system, and I think it's very good that you also ask, what about the other ones? What about the lifetime of technology? What is the other technology we can't envision? And there, the oldest planet we found is around, currently, Kepler-444, 11 billion years old. It's not an habitable zone, it's way too hot, but we know that 11 billion years ago, planets that are rocky formed. So if we find one of those at the right distance and have a look at their atmosphere, maybe we can tell you if there are technology signatures in there or not. But just envisioning on all the science we know, what could be it could be like on such a planet, I think is just fascinating.
So I can also offer my perspective on this, which is, and this is one of the rare times that I'll be a pessimist. There's something called the doomsday argument, which was published by Richard Goddard, Princeton professor, 93 or something like that, which basically states that if humanity is destined to live for billions of years and have, you know, gazillions of humans over that time, then we should be surprised to find ourselves in the first, you know, 100,000 years of humanity. Why are we in the first and not somewhere in the middle? So I kind of agree with that, and I think that humanity as we know it, with our interests and desires of exploration and all of that, has probably at most tens of thousands of years, hundreds of thousands of years, before we become completely unrecognizable and would have completely different notions of what we want to do with our lives.
Singularity is 42 years away.
Some people predict it much earlier. Yes, I mean, it could be as early as that. That said, I think, so you know, that the point is that I think that life as we know it and to which we can relate is rare. That said, I believe that life per se is common. And we have some circumstantial evidence of that, which is life on Earth formed pretty much as soon as conditions were favorable. And it didn't have to. It could have formed 5 billion years after the Earth formed, and we would still be having, you know, these kinds of discussions. But it formed pretty much as soon as conditions were favorable. Intelligence, however, did not form as soon as conditions were favorable. So that's not a scientific argument. However, it is consistent with the idea that life, microbial or whatever, is common, but intelligence as we know it and to which we can relate is rare.
Having said that, I think a really nice point in this is like life, right? If you look for you and me, in a technology phase, you're actually shrinking our space of when and where you can look in what evolutionary phase. But life, even if we kill ourselves, it's really, really hard to sterilize a planet. So even if we kill ourselves, life is probably still going to be there, you know? And I think it's relatable as much as, you know, jellyfish are relatable, if you want, or things that actually evolve on our planet, so.
I would love to find jellyfish.
Avi?
It's very popular to think about biological life, and that's what we focus on, and we look for it under conditions similar to those on Earth. But in fact, if we think about starshot, one of the lessons is that once intelligence develops, there will be a transformation into a technological phase, and perhaps the biggest signatures of intelligent life would not be to find it on a planet next to a star, but rather looking for signatures of it elsewhere in the galaxy. And the question is, what kind of signatures? So that's part of the breakthrough listen. But again, the breakthrough listen is also listening to planets next to stars. I think it would be interesting to think about things that are just out there in the galaxy, in the vast space between stars, that indicate that someone sent those things. And the question is how to search for them.
Yeah, it's not just that. It's our limited terracentric view, because we may be ourselves rapidly evolving to a post-biological intelligence. That's not my idea by any means, but you see, like, the next generation, or even us, right? We're glued to our phones. It's just a matter of time before we have implants. Even now, we have very simple things, right? Like pacemakers and artificial limbs, and there's people working on controlling their limbs and things like that. So I think we should figure out how to look for that, because it may be that our human phase is short-lived, this intelligent phase.
Can I just respond to Avi's question too, which is, if you think about evolution as a required process and one of the laws of nature, and evolution as the transfer of information from one generation to the next, survivability information, and it used to be by the number of base pairs in our DNA, there's a natural part of evolution, which now most of the information, our survivability, comes not through our DNA, it comes through our technology. And I'm a big believer in the fact that that information content, just as others have said, becomes the definition of life. And much sooner than a few thousand years, we won't be recognizable and could very well exist in some redefined concept of what information management is, completely outside of the planets, as you're describing. So I think that's a great idea, but I don't know how you look for it.
We have a question in the back.
Yeah, I just wanted to comment on the definition of intelligence. You know, we have a lot of species on this planet that have non-technological intelligence. They've been studied pretty specifically on various levels. The SETI Institute has had various workshops, discussions on how you might measure intelligence, and looking at exercises for systems on Earth, like we've looked at extremophiles as examples of extreme life. We can also look at potential other types of intelligence, granted they're not going to build telescopes, etc. And I can imagine looking for signatures of intelligence, again, non-technological, that we might be able to look at in exoplanets, and if we can figure out how species on this planet communicate that complexity, I think that would be well worth looking at.
Natalie, you had a question?
I'm finding it very interesting how the conversation in a panel on exoplanet detection has quickly morphed into a biosignature discussion. And this really is indication of our optimism and our passion for finding life and all of that. But let's dial it back a second, and let's think about finding planets. I really like that we have this method approach to finding planets. I think that's very important. I want to see radial velocities weigh in. I want to see ground or imaging in the infrared weigh in. I also want to get above the Earth's atmosphere, to go back to Sarah's point, and do some optical imaging from space. I think those are all great. And I'm interested in Alpha Centauri because it is our nearest star, And if you just took the population, if you looked at stellar populations and you took a random mix of stars and you plotted, put them down in a volume, the probability that we would be sitting next to a G dwarf is very small. This is a very unique opportunity, as Russ has indicated. So what exactly is my question? My question is, I have heard that it is considered high risk to invest a lot of money that may yield a null result. I personally feel very strongly and the opposite. a null result is very interesting to me, and I think that we should create a narrative of exploring our nearest neighbor, period. Not even just in terms of exoplanets, but in terms of the star itself. We have not resolved surface features of any main sequence star besides our sun. So I think that all of these things are really important, and so I'd love to see that narrative of just exploring our nearest neighbor really, really come to light. But my question for you guys, maybe all of you panelists, is do you think that, put a NASA hat on, like I have a NASA hat on, would you consider it to be high risk to launch a mission that would look singularly at Alpha Centauri for planets?
I want to start here and say yes, but I think this is what we're going to have to do, and it's terrifying for astronomers to think, each mission we build will only have like one star or the next five stars out or the next 10. When we think about what we wanted to do before, TPF, and like look at all the stars at once, probably it's this graduated growth. And I think for radial velocity too, you could imagine a big light bucket on the ground, but it would only hammer away at five stars. So I actually think this is our necessary way to go. And that breakthroughs innovation for this, we had a question yesterday, well, you folks, observers aren't being innovative enough. But actually, I think the innovation is in actually focusing on just one object. And in the future, like as Russ, is thinking of the binary star coronagraph, we may need like one specialized type of telescope for each small set of stars as we move outwards. So I think it's right now really scary, but actually probably has to be the way of the future.
So if I can just add something on that. So when we started with Hobbes observation, we focused on 400 stars. We wanted to look a few, 400 stars, a few measurements every month, and so on. And in the end, we went down to Neptune mass planet, more or less, close by. And then we said, okay, the problem is that we don't have good enough sampling. So then we said, let's focus on the 10 best stars with good photon noise and so on. And out of these 10 best stars, after 3 years of observation, we had 7 planets smaller than 10 Earth mass. So really focusing on a very small sample of star is really the way to go, I think.
Question from Peter.
So firstly, just to, I'm glad the discussion's come back to Breakthrough Watch. I feel like the listen guys hijacked us for a minute there. Firstly, a comment about M dwarfs. I think the habitable zone is only tidally locked beyond M4 or so. I'm no expert at that. So a lot of the M dwarfs won't be tidally locked. I think tidal locking is a killer, but the hotter end of it is probably fine. My comment is really that I think we have to be visionary and look at these big picture questions, so I kind of always feel bad because I've got something more like a bond sort of story than a risky stock. But I think we have to be agile to what's going to happen in the very near future. And the Gaia mission will find every single gas giant in the local neighborhood, all of them. A lot of those gas giants will have moons, so I'm going to put a big bottle of wine, very fine Australian wine up, that the first habitable zone planet will be a Pandora system found by Gaia. And I think I'm wondering whether Breakthrough is interested in that scenario and what we would do about it.
So we looked at this question a couple of years back when, by coincidence, the Pandora movie came out. How do you characterize a habitable moon? And it is finding it, no issue. Oh, well. Hard, but doable. But actually, you have just multiplied the problem that you have, because now to actually see the atmospheric feature or figure out if there's life on that moon, you not only have to get rid of the star, you also have to get rid of the planet. So I give you that Gaia might find the giant planets who have moons, and people will herald them.
Gaia will also find the moons, because there'll be perturbations.
True. Yeah. And people will herald them as being the habitable worlds. But the problem is to actually scientifically have a look at it and verify it, I don't think these are going to be the first ones, because it's just so much harder because they have a planet nearby. So I think I would say don't forget about them, but just from scientific principles to actually characterize them, that's a much harder ballgame. So the planets, and what we were saying, you were saying we're so close, and I agree with you. We're having tests coming up. We're having searches on the ground, finding the closest end of space. Planets, and they might be around M-stars. And here I completely do not share your pessimism insofar that the studies have shown if you just have enough. The problem is we are somehow linked to our vision of Mercury when we think about tightly locked planets. But Mercury does not have an atmosphere that can actually transport the energy. We can make an energy budget. You can rotate the planet as little as you want. You can make an energy budget, and that energy will be transported even without an ocean. And so all of these things, I think the problem is like we are sometimes very married to our own solar system, to conceptions that we got from school. I find myself doing the same thing, right? I'm like, oh, synchronously tightly locked. Oh my God. It's not even a problem for photosynthetic plants. Three quarters of life on the Earth doesn't need light. Right? So if you're on the dark side, it's not
water.
A problem. But yeah, it needs water. But I just think, you know, unraveling what really the underlying bias of us is to worry about planets around M stars, I think leads you to a lot of Earth-centric or solar system-centric issues. Having said that, the only thing that helps us is looking. But the moons will be interesting. They will be heralded as the first habitable worlds, I have no doubt. But actually confirming that is going to be way harder than do this around a planet in the habitable zone around a close by star.
So we'll take a question from the person in back here. And after you're done, you can move the microphone one row in the front, and then Jack.
Got it. So I had a question about star shades for Alpha Centauri. So I'm just a software guy, but I'll blurt it out anyway. Wondered if there'd been any thought of sort of getting the star shade for free in the sense of parking something in L4 or L5, something that's gravitationally simple enough to do kind of down to the centimeter station keeping with the moon so that you can really maintain down to sub-arc-second occultation, just the beginning of an occultation, at least get a 180-degree clear view of habitable zone.
Yeah, I should take that one. We continue to search for solutions like that are practical in terms of the astrodynamics, and so far we have failed, and I keep hoping that such a solution will appear, but so far no luck.
Jack?
A few quick comments on things that were just raised, and then my question / challenge to the observers. And the comments are, finding a moon of a planet in the habitable zone is going to be more difficult with Gaia or just about anything else I can think of than finding a comparable size planet in the habitable zone. TESS will find the best targets for transmission spectroscopy, but it's unlikely to find the nearest planets because most planets aren't transiting. My view on whether a null result is important is if that result goes saying that there are not Earth analogs or something even really better if it's not Mars-sized planets, then it's very interesting scientifically, but super Earths, that's not an interesting null result. But my main thing is my challenge, and I think it's to the observers. I hope one of you can start a response with, "You dumb theorist," or "You naive theorist," whatever. Alpha Centauri has three stars. And to me, the best way to study the possibility of planets around two of those stars is with special built instrumentation for those stars. But of the third star, C or Proxima, it's not special built. And that's just, you know, I'm a theorist, and does any observer have a different viewpoint? Wondered.
I can answer part of this question, not all of it. For direct imaging, that's mostly true. Russ mentioned that the challenge for direct imaging around Proxima is that
the habitable zone is very close. It's about 20 milliarcseconds. So it's inevitably going to require very large aperture, which we will get when ELTs get built, and then even larger telescopes in the future. NASA may launch a comparable size aperture at some time in the future, and at shorter wavelengths, we don't need quite as big a telescope. So there are opportunities to do this, none of them very soon. A and B for direct imaging offers unique opportunities to do direct imaging quite soon, and Russ talked about this. I think there's also an interesting question about radio velocity, and maybe Xavier can tell us about what his thoughts are on radio velocity for A and B versus Proxima. We didn't talk about radio velocity for Proxima. Maybe you can mention this.
So I think what the good thing about radio velocity is that you don't need a specific mission for just A and B. Like, you can do A and B, it's very bright, but you can kill some photons. There is no problem there. Then from A and B and Proxima, it's a little bit different because, of course, M dwarfs, you have much more flux in the infrared, so it's much better to go into infrared spectroscopy. Then you have some other issues there, atmospheres and so on. But I think what is nice about radial velocity is that with one instrument, you can observe like the 10, 20 closest star to the sun and not just do one.
So I might disagree on that. I really think that we shouldn't be messing around with Alpha Centauri. I think everything that the panel said about whether there are planets there, you know, every extrapolation that's been done by theory has been wrong, and there are a lot of reasons that planet formation in that system is challenging. There's also a lot of promise that there will be planets there, but what we have to do is buckle down and actually take an inventory of the planets in that system. And so I almost think, Xavier, that the HARPS is the best instrument that's operating right now, no question about it. And what you showed is that the RMS that you can get looking at the sun, where you're not photon starved, is about 0.3 meters per second. And we've also seen that that's not what we need. That doesn't put the limits on detecting the kind of planets that are still allowed. And so we have a pathway, which you and I are sort of working on, in terms of using very high resolution, but also very high signal to noise. And I think that if you, by the time you go to 300,000 resolution, it is a special purpose, single purpose instrument. The instrument we use on high res and at Lick Observatory is resolution 55,000. HARPS is 115,000, right? We're talking about a resolution of 300,000 means you're spreading the light out three times more. Right, and so the number to get the photon counts to a signal to noise of 1,000, which is also what you need to disentangle the photospheric velocities. We're talking about a special purpose-built instrument. Michael Endelos was right yesterday. It needs to be behind an AO system, because I am so tired of dealing with contamination from one of those stars in the other spectrum. And your idea is we want to put it at two different longitudes so that we observe the system night and day, around the rotation of the Earth. Just, you know, don't mess around with it, because we're talking about something that costs, I don't know, $10 million, right, on a venture that is $1 billion. So just do it and do it right. That's my hope.
I agree.
We'll take a question, and then you can pass the microphone to Phil.
All right. So I'd like to go back to biosignatures. And I think the challenge here is not really to find this particular biosignature or biopigment which we know in Earth life. It's a challenge to look at us as life from outside and understand why this biosignature, why this biopigment evolved, what was the selection, what was the environmental challenge for pressure for this selection. And then maybe generalize this idea that there is this process of selection as a pressure of the environment, and then we go to other planets and maybe kind of look for general signature, not for a particular one. And I think that would be something interesting to do in the laboratories, for instance. And in response to Natalia's comments, I want to say that actually Colossus telescope, which Jeff mentioned, will be able to see spots on the Alpha Centauri directly. And this can be our second sun to study and to understand the physics of the stars. That will be quite exciting as well to do.
Do you want to reply or? Oh, sorry. So I think one of the things that is important is that we basically have two ways to go. I agree that I would love to understand the environmental forcing and so on and so forth. We basically looked into this, and this pigmentation catalog that we have, for example, you would guess, as an astronomer when we started out with this, that there would be correlation. But if you have a look, the pigmentation color, even if you do a high-resolution spectroscopy, does not necessarily correlate with the environment. So this is a thing where we actually use the data of all the life that we have to get to some fundamental understanding, as you were saying, but it basically points to, and anybody who's doing biology in the room, it points to that there are many different ways to get to a certain kind of biosignature, whether it's pigmentation, whether it's gases, and so on and so forth. And untangling that would be amazing. But because we don't have many other data points, I think it's really going to be the observations that then going to inform us which path a planet or environment takes, and not the other way around, that we can use this one sample, the Earth, even so we have a long, wide range of things to make that understanding happen. And that's, for me, one of the key points of the search. We talk about life in the universe and so on, and that, I think, is exciting. But understanding this planet, safeguarding this planet, and I applaud your sentiment that you've sent 10 people out when the sun has gone to white and so on, but we need to understand this one better, and the sample of one, our own Earth, is just not cutting it in a way. So if we had 100 more Earths and so on, just to understand the planet better and safeguard this one, where we live and where we're going to live for a long time. And also the notion that another planet would be better is something that I find funny. You know, could
we've had
be,
some practice, I just want to say, because we worked on exoplanet, giant planets, let's say for 10 years before we had any data. Now there's data. And with the hot Jupiters that have been studied now by huge numbers of people, we don't totally know what's going on. We don't understand what they were born with, even if they're around a star that's very similar. And so we've had experience in like the simplest case, and we don't understand it. So that sometimes when we throw up our arms and we just want to take this big data approach instead of trying to understand evolution.
I just want to make two quick points that are actually questions as well as points. The first is that when we phase up the array in the receive mode, we will have a 2 nanoradian beam size. If we don't have that, then we have other problems. If we have that at Alpha Centauri, we will have about a spot size, which is of order 10 to the 8th meters, which is, you know, about 4 times that of the Earth or so. And that opens up interesting possibilities. Also, with such a large number of phased elements, you can produce a beam response pattern which has a deep null near the star. So you might just let that trickle in your mind and see what comes out. The other
Colossus comes out. You've just described Colossus.
Yeah, it's ultra Colossus. Anyway, okay. So just think about that. It has, you have to think about the phase coherence issues, though, and the bandwidths. But the other point is related to this issue of sort of human evolution in the long term and getting off the planet at high speed. As those of you who are physicists know, a photon does not have a clock. So, in fact, there's only 2 dimensions for a photon, 2 spatial and no time. So as we send people out at increasingly higher speeds, we, you know, face this paradigm shift, which is that they're not coming back to anything they know, as was mentioned. But also, during the time that they are gone, the evolutionary technology of the Earth has expanded dramatically. As we talked about the other day, there's this sort of E-folding time, which is short compared to human lifetime. Now when you expand that into relativistic flight, you have a complete change in the entire paradigm of sort of the philosophy of how we think about ourselves. And if you could comment on that, and then comment on, you know, if there is nothing out there that we know about, we ought to be doing what plants do, which is we ought to be spreading our seeds throughout the universe, which is a highly controversial topic, I realize, but something we ought to ponder.
So if I could talk about telescopes for a minute. In order to get to bigger telescopes than the ELTs that we're talking about, they're no longer fixed primary telescopes. They're partially filled interferometric telescopes where we do exactly what I think you're describing, which is we make nulls by changing the phase of those elements. And in fact, that's probably the best way to do a lot of the dynamic range imaging that we know we have to do. The theme of I think what I would like to see Breakthrough do for us is give us a path forward that produces a dedicated instrument. And as you know, receiving photons and sending photons is effectively the same problem. So whatever we build for you and your little potato chips is going to be...
They're Pringles, not potatoes.
Pringles. I can't eat just one. I think that you're right. That's terribly exciting. A lot of the problems that we're describing now for detectability will become much, much easier when we can collect more than a photon an hour from the exoplanet. And that's the optimism that's the wave I'm surfing on right now.
Maybe I can comment on your second part, and I agree with Jeff has said, and I think that the Starshot array could, in principle, be a very good imaging instrument for exoplanets. I think the second part of your question was, if I understood correctly, when talking about interstellar relativistic flight, you have to take into account the advances, technological advances that happen on Earth and all of that stuff. Yeah, I completely agree with that. My point was just that we should not assume that it takes billions of years to go somewhere because of the Starship time is short. And I think a lot of people don't appreciate that.
We'll take two last questions before we break for lunch. So Peter, and then if you can pass the microphone behind you.
I've just got two quick sales pitches to put in for Alpha Sen. One sales pitch is to do with the Antarctic, because Alpha Sen, of course, is circumpolar there. And you get 6 months of lovely darkness, and the high plateau there, you get, we believe, something like 0.2 arc seconds if you get above the inversion layer. If you're below the inversion layer, it's awful seeing, but all you've got, a 30-meter tower is not very hard to build. And my second sales pitch is for photonic technologies, and Olivier has been very supportive of a bunch of stuff we're putting on Skexeo from Sydney, but if you want to build an hour of 100,000 spectrograph, we can put one in the footprint of an iPhone. So I could imagine doing this experiment on Alpha Sen for cheap if you can put a Celestron telescope with a good seeing in Antarctica and feed it into a single mode fiber and then into a shoebox size instrument. The whole thing could be done. So yeah, that's what we're here for, right? Breakthrough technologies, and this could be an easy way to make progress. So, sales pitches, my apologies.
Any comment on this? I don't have anything to comment.
I think it sounds great in principle. What is the sky brightness in Antarctica, given that the sun never goes too far below the horizon? And would that preclude you from...
Alpha Sen is a zeroth magnitude star. It's... overwhelmingly brighter than any. So the sky bright, yes, you're right, you have a long twilight. You still have a few months of good darkness, and in Dome A is significantly far from the pole, so you get daily variation there. It gets lighter and darker even in the winter. But there's a few months where it's very dark, and there's not very much aurora at Dome A. It's within the auroral circle. Not so for Dome C. Anyway, these things have been, there are papers out there you can find, site testing with exquisite detail.
We'll take one last question.
So I'm fascinated by this model that's sitting on the desk. So you said that's half scale, is that correct?
Yes, and by the way, Eduardo Bendig is sitting back there. He's responsible for designing the mechanics and printing it.
So I'm trying to understand like the risk thing that was brought up earlier. I mean, this thing is tiny. People smuggle guitars onto the International Space Station and teddy bears. You could just chuck that thing outside of the hatch, right, in principle. It just seems like it's relatively cheap to launch this thing. What's the reason why it hasn't really happened yet, like dedicated small missions like this to something like Alpha Centauri? I mean, you could launch 10 of these things or 10 of the nearest stars.
That's the question I'm asking too. the main reason I think, well, there's several. One is that there's a perception that the null result has no value. And so there's a real risk that there are no planets that this thing could detect around Alpha Centauri. And then people argue that has no value. Also the technology readiness level of some of the technologies needs to be brought up a little bit higher. There are no fundamental showstoppers. It just needs
funding and a little bit of time to bring them up. The null result is not something that we can do anything about in terms of, you know, nature is what it is, and we can't change that. But I think that there is value in the null result, because if you don't find any planets there, you don't need to then have larger missions impose requirements on their instrument to look for it. And also, it's a good data point for dynamicists to then try to explain why are there any planets around Alpha Centauri.
Well, I just want to add one thing, and it's fine if you want to get the final word, but we may have forgot to convey just how difficult it is. Remember the yesterday, if you remember the charts for Alpha Centauri and the contrast, Earth in reflected light is 10 billion times fainter than the sun. So he's got to null out that star to one part in 10 billion, but maybe he's doing that to one part in 10 to the 7 because he's going to rely on 100 or 1,000 in post-processing. But it's super, super challenging. So it's amazing that we're at the stage now where he's got this model and a plan and how to go forward. But it's tremendously challenging. And that's why you can't just launch 10 or launch one right away.
Yeah. Sarah is absolutely correct. It is challenging. But but nothing that's not challenging is worth doing.
It certainly doesn't appear significantly more challenging than Starshot. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for the audience also for asking all those great questions.